when I'm walking past the mirror. Don't stress through the night at a time in my life. Ain't worried about if you feel it. Got my head on straight, I got my vibe right. I ain't gonna let you kill it. See, I won't change.
Hello and welcome to A Seat at the Table. I'm Deneen Milner.
I'm Christine White, and today we're discussing what it means to be mixed race in America.
And I'm Monica Pearson. Historically, the one drop rule said that having a certain percentage of African American blood meant you were black. But does that rule still apply today?
Okay, white, black, mulatto, Chinese, yes, hello, good. Quadroon. No, I see you. And an Indian? No. A person of mixed black and American Indian lineage is also to be recorded as black. I heard you call me white twice now, and I have something to say about that. So, I am Blackfeet Indian and Cherokee and Danish.
Oh, I tell you what that one drop does. You know, my feelings on the one drop rule is this was not our invention. This was a construct of an extremely racist society that could not stand the idea of black people having any kind of say, power, standing, footing in this country. So now that we, you know, get to the point where we're like claiming people, like President Obama. I'm a claim President Obama. I understand that, you know, he's half black and half white, but I get to claim him as black, and then I heard people trying to claim him as white or trying to say that he's biracial, he's not just black, right? And I'm just like, well, this was your idea. This one drop thing was your idea, so don't try to take it back now.
Well, I mean, I feel like when we talk about race, we're really talking about an experience. Mm-hmm. Because there is no biological connection between the color of your skin and the blood that flows through your veins. Like, race is not a real biological thing, right? It's just a social thing. But back when slaves were brought to this country, white and black, they decided at some point that the white slaves could earn citizenship after working so much and the black slaves couldn't. And of course, that was all about an economic design to keep poor white people and poor black people from revolting against the rich people who were oppressing them all.
Right.
And so that's where it started from, and that's why it continues. But I think that the idea of whether or not we're gonna claim someone or what experience they're having is relevant in today's society, because we want to be able to say, this is what it's like to be a black person, this is what it's like to be a white person, this is what it's like to be a female, this is what it's like to be a male. Those experiences are valuable, and what I have found is that in America, if you say anything about race, all of a sudden you're a racist. Mm-hmm. But that's only because there's so much pain associated with race. Not just our historical perceptions of race, but our current understanding and experiences with race.
But we've got to get to the place where we understand that our country is becoming more, and I use the old-fashioned term, colored. Because the Census Bureau says by 2045, whites will be the minority in the United States of America. Not only because of the influx of Hispanic, the growth of the black population, Asian population, but also because of interracial dating and marriage. So you can no longer define a person, as you say, by a race, because if you look at all of us, we all are mixed race. It's just some of us show the qualities of one race more than the other. Right. And I think that that's what concerns me more about this one drop rule. Because, you know, we could all sit here and say, well, we got one drop, so that makes us white.
Right. It never works the other way around.
It never
right?
works the other
ever.
Way around.
Right.
Never, ever does.
It's because you experience being black. You don't experience being white. And if you don't experience life as a white person, you shouldn't be claiming it.
Hmm. Well, here's the other thing with President Barack Obama. He experienced race as a white person and as a black person.
I don't believe it. But
growing up, he grew up with his white family. And yes, he did receive discrimination because people said, we know your father's black, so we're gonna make you black. But when you look at how he grew up, his culture was more white than black.
Now, that may be true.
However, he embraced his blackness. But then you look at someone like Mariah Carey. For years, right, you know, we all thought she's white, even though we knew she's biracial.
Well, she acted like she was until those record sales started.
Right, until she needed all
the
masks.
Then all of a sudden it was Jermaine Dupri, can I get a beat though?
Right, right. People want to be black when it's convenient.
Exactly. We've got to take a quick break, but don't go anywhere, because when we come back, we will be joined by a biracial man with a unique perspective.
Will you take this tray into Miss Laura and her friends?
Why, certainly. Anything at all for Miss Laura and her friends. Fetched you all a mess of crawdads, Miss Laura, for you and your friends.
Well, that's quite a trick, Sarah Jane. Where did you learn it?
Oh, no trick to tote, Miss Laura. I learned it from my mammy, and she learned it from old Massa, for she belonged to you.
You weren't being colored. You were being childish. I don't understand why you would want to hurt your mother or me.
I told her she has to be patient. Things will work out.
How? Miss Laura, you don't know what it means to be different.
Mm. Welcome back to A Seat at the Table. That was the second version of, I love this story, The Imitation of Life. We're now joined by Bishop Richard Lankford, the first African-American to be elected sheriff in the state of Georgia. He's also the bishop at the Atlanta International Christian Praise Center. And the woman was a biracial child who, at that day and time, hated the fact that she didn't fit in either world, the black world or the white world. Your parents started dating in 1937.
Yeah. Yeah, amazing, isn't it?
I hate to say it, were they crazy?
Right, like, how does that even work?
How did that work?
Shows you the power of love, first of all. Love and character. Love is able to move away from the fears that we have a lot of times. When love overpowers fear, then you take actions that other people wonder how you could take them. So it was just a very, very strong element of love that they had for one another. It was amazing to me.
So what did he lose and what did she lose by having this relationship?
Well, amazingly, he didn't lose very much of anything. My mother, on the other hand, who was white, of course, was ostracized for quite a long time because of her family. And it took a while for those relationships to mend. And I think, as I mentioned before, they mended pretty well as the years progressed, except for one white sister that my sister and I have, who never accepted us as her brother or her mm-hmm. sister. And she refused to, up until the day she left and went home.
Oh, wow. Wow.
But so they were both challenged, but I think my mother was challenged a great deal more than my father was challenged, because we've always known that the black community has been more receptive
yes.
to interracial yep. marriage than the white community, simply because I think we understood that the black race was a very beautifully mixed culture, and the white race had this mentality that there's a white purity that must be maintained, and if that is violated, then that is not acceptable. Mm-hmm. So my mother had a more difficult time than my dad did. So
now, you look white, and on your baby pictures, you looked really white. Why didn't you pass during that time period?
I think probably because the environment, because they had to live in the black community. Mm. Then I grew up in the black community. I grew up listening to black music, but I remember my mother and father were also older. I think my mother was 46 and my father was 49 when I was born. So I grew up listening to black music. I mean, Muddy Waters, Fats Waller, Mahalia Jackson, right. Nat King Cole, big bands, and then coming along later, all of the Motown sounds. So in spite of my complexion,
right.
my environment and my surroundings were totally in the black community. I grew up in the black church, mm. grew up playing black gospel music, black Christian music.
So you identified as black, but did anyone ever mistake you for being white?
Mostly when they had race riots and they were chasing me through the streets,
Oh, you mean black people chasing you through the streets?
Listen, we talk about discrimination. We had race riots, and that was with whites, Hispanics, and blacks. I ran from everybody because nobody could figure out what I was.
Oh, goodness.
So,
stay at home. You know, stay at home.
So it was, you know, so it was, that was a part of a challenge. But no, I moved, I had this affinity for the black community. Our neighbors were black, but, you know, for the most part, we had, I think, a white couple that lived across the street, believe it or not, in our neighborhood. Other than that, everybody else was black. So that was my identification. And so when I hear the term biracial, when I hear the term mixed, I don't assimilate to that because, think about it, when I grew up, okay, I'm getting my driver's license. So I'm, on the application, there is no mix. There is no biracial when I'm coming along. It's just white, black, other. Mm-hmm. You know, I refuse to be other. So, of course, I identified black. And I'll tell you why. You know who told me I was black?
Who?
My white mother.
Well.
Wow.
Well, she knew. She knew.
Well, it happened because when I was growing up, they never, I never knew initially there was a difference in race. I know it's hard to believe, but I knew I had a mother. And I knew I had a father. They loved me, they took care of me, and my sister had a wonderful family. So early, I didn't realize there was a difference in race. The way I found out was, in elementary school, me and a young guy got into an argument, and he said, oh, go home and tell your old white mama. And so here comes this light bulb that comes on all of a sudden. Boom! Right. Your mother's white. So me and this guy get into a fight, where when I get home, I get beat like a bad child from my mama for fighting. But then it was my mother who sat down with me because I said, what am I? Mm. My mother said, you are black.
Wow.
And why?
My white mother.
Right. Why would she say that?
She said, because black is the most beautiful race because it is a mixture of cultures from all over the world. White is one race by itself without any mixture. You can't be white because of your father.
Did that ever change, or did you ever waver from that as you got older?
No.
I mean, the way that people responded to you when you got older, if someone wasn't aware of you having a white mother and a black father, and you walk into a room and nobody knows your race, the assumption could be, that you're white.
Listen, I tried,
When I
went to Chicago Teachers College, which was later Chicago State University, when I went there, they just started the Black Panther Party movement. I said, I'm going and see what this is about. Oh, I got no further than the front door.
Wow.
They said, no white folk allowed. I said, hey, guy jacked the chill in the shotgun and said, I said, no white folk allowed. So, again, I appeared, you know, to be white.
So back to our conversation about race is what you experience. I never until now realized that being mixed race is a distinctive experience from potentially being black, being white. That being mixed race is an experience of maybe not always fitting in or not being identified in either.
Because think about this. You're discriminated on a number of levels.
Right.
There are a certain number of black women who do not want to see black men with white women.
Right.
There's a certain number of black men or black women, either one, who do not want to see the male or the female of their race with a member of the other race. Right. It's the same on the white side.
Right. Mm,
you know, white men do not want to see white women with black men.
Right.
You know, and the same for white women. So we're in a category where we say we're black, but a lot of times we've even been discriminated.
Now, let me ask you about your parents, because both of them had been married before to people of their same race.
Oh, yeah. How much time you got for this one? Listen, my mom and dad, my mom, who was white, was married to a white fellow before she met my father. My father, who was black, was married to a black woman before he met my mother. Mm-hmm. So I have brothers and sisters that are all black. I have brothers and sisters that are all white. And then I have another sister, Nola, of course, who is black like me.
I notice you don't use the biracial. Because when you look at people like the president, President Barack Obama, we were talking about Mariah Carey, Halle Berry, and the list gets longer and longer. The children that Kim Kardashian is producing. Sure. How are they going to fit into this world now? Because we're seeing more and more black and white couples.
I think it's going to be a general justice. There will never be a period in our history where interracial relationships, families, children, will not face some kind of challenge. There will never be, because there's always a mindset of what is right and what is not right in a person's opinion, not in terms of what a standard and character of society may say. So there's always going to be a challenge there. But I mean, we talk about bloodlines. Now, my grandfather on my mother's side was German. My grandmother on my mother's side was Lithuanian Dutch. My great-great-grandfather on my father's side was Bahamian from the Bahamas. So what do you do?
Right.
You know, it and I'm not going to, I started to do the DNA thing and I said,
you should.
They don't have that much paper.
Way too much. So tell me this. When you started dating, did you ever think about whether or not you would date a white woman or a black woman, or how did that work?
That's interesting. When you come up in my era, we didn't have a lot of female images. And so you start out, you watch TV, then you get hit with this Brigitte Bardot or this Marilyn Monroe thing, but then boom, you get hit with this Dorothy Dandridge thing, and so you begin to see. Now, my mother had a picture of my sister on the mantle in our living room, and I always ask her, who is this movie star here? But it was my sister, but she just looked like somebody out of Hollywood.
Right.
What happened was, I went to college, I went to a science program while I was a junior in high school. 30 young people from across the United States were chosen. Went to McMurray, Illinois. I met a young white girl, by the name of Laurie Ziegler, and she lived in Aurora, Illinois, and we became very good friends, and I thought I was gonna like her. First time I wrote to her, she wrote back and said, please do not write me anymore. My parents have advised me that we don't associate with colored people.
Wow. I'll tell you.
And so, you know, it was...
Wow. I dated a man who's your complexion, but he's half black, half white. His father's black, his mom's white. He identified as a black man. I knew him as nothing else but a black man. But if we were walking down the street, everybody assumed that he was a white man and would say the craziest things to us. And I remember one night, we probably had a little bit too much champagne, and we were walking down the street, it was late, and someone started spewing like Bible verses at us, Bible verses that were patently, you know, like, this is not supposed to happen type stuff.
Wow.
And he turned around, he's like, my father's blacker than her.
Right.
So what are you talking about? Right? Yeah. I'm a black man. And I just remember, like, wow, I'd never experienced dating interracially, but that was as close as I had gotten to it.
Sure. And so sometimes those are the kind of things that you want to scream. I mean, how many times have I been called half-breed? Or old yellow?
I got that one.
Right. Yeah, you got that too, right?
She catches that one, right?
But it's the upbringing in your family that solidifies your peace of mind in terms of who you are.
Right.
But, you know, you were in Chicago versus being mixed race, biracial in the South during that time period.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking about your mother. Was she not... I know she told you were a black man, but how did she deal with giving you that part of her culture that she felt you should know about, like you said, your grandparents?
Yeah. Well, she shared that because as her family began to accept it, her family came to visit us. We became acquainted with our grandparents on her side and our sisters, those that, and our brothers, because I had two brothers as well, Teddy and Bobby. So she made sure that we appreciated and understood our roots from her side of the family as well. Of course, it was difficult because when my grandfather and grandmother passed, we were not allowed to go.
Wow.
To
the funeral?
To their funerals.
That's crazy.
On my father's side, Aunt Nola, who my sister was named after when she passed, we were not allowed to go to her funeral.
So to the black folks' funeral?
To that funeral. Because now that was down in Paris, Tennessee. So, because that was part of my daddy's local roots down there. So, I mean, all of those things kind of blended together. And I think I told you my mother helped me through so much, and my sister, because Teddy, my one of my white brothers, used to come and live with us. Mm-hmm. And I told you, Teddy, I'd watch him. He'd be cleaning. He'd put his suit on and his tie on, and he'd be grooming himself. Then he'd do his hair, and he'd comb it, and then he'd flip it back, and he'd mm-hmm. comb it, and he'd flip. I tried for 6 months to comb and flip, and my mama finally said, it won't work.
That's not
so later on, and later on, of course, when I was in college, then I decided that I'm gonna grow a fro. Mm-hmm. You know, had a fro out to here. Problem is, it was so thin, it mm-hmm. wasn't strong enough, yeah. so the wind would blow and it would
flop this way and flop
it
that, way.
That way. So, but all of it, it was not negative.
Right.
There were
right.
some challenges.
Right.
But it wasn't destructive. Right. Yeah. I think I turned out pretty good. Wow. So.
Do you think, I mean, you were a sheriff in the city yeah. of Atlanta forever, and do you think that you have a better appreciation for race relations because you came from a mixed
sure.
race family?
Sure. Totally disallow judgment on race.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Totally disallow any judgment based on race
yeah.
whatsoever. It's character. It's conversation. Character and conversation help me to form mm-hmm. My opinion or how I feel you are in terms of your own character, mm-hmm. and not based on race, because being sheriff, you have to be sheriff to everybody.
I would love to hear more about your parents. In the 30s, when they met, how did they meet?
Well, you know, it was different. My mom had friends that she went to a nightclub with. My daddy played the trumpet.
Okay.
He's a musician. She was a musician. And she heard my father play the trumpet and sing and fell in love with him. So over the next few years, they snuck and met. I think my sister, they met in the cornfields and wow. just everywhere. And they snuck and met because they knew, of course, it was dangerous.
Yes.
In those days, they would have lynched my father had they caught him with my mother during those days. And then they ultimately moved to Chicago.
Right.
And then they finally got married. But it was very, very difficult, more so for her than it was for him. But when they went to work in Chicago, they worked at the same plant. They had to go different ways to get to the job. They couldn't speak to each other on the job or have lunch on the job, and they had to go home separately.
Can you imagine?
From one another.
With you know, the person that you love yeah. not being able yeah. to sit and have lunch yeah. at work?
Yeah, but they were determined that they were gonna get on their feet, they were gonna move to the next economic level, and whatever they had to do that, they would do it. She was so amazing. My father was too, but mine was so amazing. When we moved onto the west side of Chicago, my mother and father, there was a huge lot on the other side of our house. They cut it down with a push lawnmower and a sickle and built a baseball field. Mm. So the kids in the neighborhood could have somewhere to wow. play baseball. Now, you'd see them coming out with trays of sandwiches and Kool-Aid and stuff
wow.
and feeding the kids. May not seem like much, but later on in life,
right.
some of those kids grew up to be some of the worst gang members in Chicago. But they had a rule out. Nobody touches the Lankford house.
Right. Mm,
wow. That's something.
Because
that's
right. some of those gang members had been those little kids
right.
that she
right.
had fed.
Right.
When they were playing on the baseball
right.
lot.
Right.
So, I mean, she made herself fit in. And mm-hmm. my father, mm-hmm. hand in hand with her,
mm-hmm.
You know, just a wonderful relationship. Right. And so it was good for us.
And what's been really good from it is to see how you and your sister developed into the people you are, you serving in the ministry, actually bringing people together. And I think that since we are seeing so many people in our country now moving towards more integration, truly, both socially and spiritually, and of course, marrying,
sure.
That we've got to get to the place that your mother talked about.
Yes. Yeah.
Because whether we know it or not, you may look white, but you are black.
Yeah.
And so we have to accept us for who we are.
Absolutely. I just thank you for sharing your story, and thank you for putting into perspective what it means to be the child of two courageous people who chose to love.
Oh, I enjoyed
it. Despite what anybody else had to say about it. I think it's just a
big debate in college.
Story.
I was in a psychology class, and a professor decided to speak on the social maladjustment of the offspring of interracial marriages.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
Well, he talked for about 10 minutes, and then I talked the rest of the class.
Right.
Yeah.
I'll bet.
Well, I think that there are adjustments that need to be made. It does take effort, and I appreciate that your parents put forth that effort, and I hope that we live in a better world because of it.
You all are just wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We have to go, but the conversation doesn't end here.
Share your thoughts with us on social media.
And we're on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at ASATTTV.
Thanks for joining us for A Seat at the Table. And in the words of Shirley Chisholm, if they don't give you a seat at the table,
bring a folding chair. Now, don't abide equality, and it's you either.